Shall we start?
Yes.
Okay, good afternoon, everybody. So welcome to the seminar today. So we have a guest speaker today, Fide Gwen. So she's so let me briefly introduce her. So she's a lecturer at the School of Information and Communication Technology, Hanoi University of Science and Technology. And actually, she studied in Japan. So she got her bachelor's and master's degree from the University of Tokyo. And then she got her PhD in National Institute of Informatics in Tokyo. So currently she's the dean of the AI Center.
Yes, director.
Yeah, yes. At the University of Science and Technology. And today she will talk about actually part of a big project, the trustworthy AI in smart health and a case study in Vietnam. So we are very much looking forward to your talk. So okay. Please.
Good afternoon, everyone. And I would like to thank Professor Sugiyama for inviting me here, and thank you all for your time today, joining my talk today. And in my presentation today, so I would like to share with you about our project on trustworthy AI in smart health and a case study in Vietnam. So in my presentation, so I first introduce about our VIP project, and then I go to our two topics, research topic. The first one is about reliable and explainable multi-pupil detection framework. And the second is about federated learning with non-ideal and uncontrollable clients data. So first I want to share about our motivation for starting our project. The VIP project is the one try to applying AI to help Vietnamese people in taking care of their health. So as you can see in the slide, so in the left side we have a graph that's showing that the ratio of doctors and nurses in Vietnam are much lower than that in other Southeast Asia countries, and we are in a shortage of physician, and the need for healthcare service has been these years because of the aging population and because of changing from communicable to non-communicable diseases. And this situation in such a situation, so we should give people the means to take care of their health and to make them more proactively to taking care of their health by their own, and so that we can alleviate pressure on medical facilities. And besides the need for healthcare services, so in Vietnam we also tackle some like a special issue specific for Vietnam. For example, in Japan, so if you want to buy medicine, so you have to get the prescription from doctor. But in Vietnam, everyone can buy medicine without a prescription. Mm-hmm. Yes. And actually more than 88% of antibiotics are sold without a prescription. Yes. And this fact leads to an overuse of antibiotics in Vietnam. And moreover, in our country, so most of like health related document like a health record or prescription are paper-based with they have not been like digitalized. So that is very difficult for user to like manage and monitor their information related to their health. And the few mistaken is also happened in our country. So this chaos situation necessitates a need for useful tool that can help people to manage their information related to their health. And that is motivation of our project. And the VIP project is a big project funded by a very big company in Vietnam, VinIF. And our objective is to build an intelligent healthcare system to assist users in collecting and managing and analyzing their health related data. And our system enable users to collect data from multiple sources and using only smartphone camera. So we mean that by using only one smartphone camera, so user can collect all the data related to their health. And we also provide visualization of analytical and predicted results and we offer some function that support user in monitoring their health, like reminding of medication schedule or warning of early disease risk. And this project is a collaboration between our university and Finn University in Vietnam and University of Massachusetts, Boston, and University of South Florida in US. So I will go through the main function of our system. We have six main functions. The first one is locating and recognizing pills in a picture. So we have a smartphone app, and with our application, so user can take pictures of pills, and our system can localize and recognize the ID and the name of pill, and automatically record that information into the smartphone of the user. And so with the ID or the name of pill, so user can obtain the information about the medicine, like effect or side effect or dose, by using their phone. And the third function is to extract information from prescription images, because as I said before, so on the most of prescription in Vietnam is paper based, so it's very difficult to like to collect the prescription. So by using our app, so user can capture the image of all the prescription, and the information of all prescription will be stored in the smartphone. And the next function is to remind the medication intake given the information from prescription. Like our application will remind the user about the time to take the pill. And we also have a function to detect the medication misuse by mapping the information from the pill images and the information from prescription, so we can detect the medication misuse. And finally, we have a function that help people to collect information, health indicators from various device, like by using only one app of our YP app, so user can capture the image of various devices, and we will automatically classify which device, and then we record the information into the smartphone of the user. So in the development of our system, so we tackle many research problems, and there are two problems that we have spent much of our effort on. That is the pill detection problem, and the second one is distributed learning. That is how to train model in a distributed manner from using data from multiple clients to train a model. And okay, so now I will go to the detail of and our research, our achievement concerning these two research problems. So for the first one, I would like to introduce my student, Nguyễn Anh Duy. He takes the main role in this research, and he will present about this one.
Okay, sorry for the interruptions, and I hope all of you can still hear me. Now I will present my major work in this project, which is called Accuracy and Explainable Multi-Pill Detections Framework with Graph Neural Network Assisted Multi-Model Information Fusion. Here's the agenda for the description of the talk. First, I will present the motivations as well as the related work. Next, I will introduce my proposed framework. And finally, assess its performance. Okay, next. Now let's go to the motivations as well as the related work. Talking about medicine, we only aware of its good side, positive effect. However, if you wrongly use them, it can lead to serious consequences of diminish the treatment efficacy, cause adverse effect, or the final lethal consequence. Here are some facts about medical issues over the world, as well in my country, which is Vietnam. And from the statistic, you can see that the problem of misuse of drug is a very serious problem. Here is the illustration that describes one of the major reasons that caused the great misuse of drug case. As you can see, there are three types of pill which appear in the slide, which is a Yale, Mayona, and Betasec. And since all these pills look very identical, hence the patients cannot differentiate them and then take the wrong type of pill. To this end, I devote my work to study the problem of real-world pill detections, in which I will provide an image which capture what the patient actually consumed. And I will first localize the positions of each pill and then to correctly classify each of them with the correct label. About the related work, in fact, pill detection is a subproblem of a general object detection task in computer vision, which is called intra-class object detections. So compared with the general one, here is an illustration of the general object detection task. And as you can see, the object in each class has demonstrated the great visual variance between the class, and the framework should only rely on the cross features to differentiate them. In addition, there is also a depth dimensions in the image. For example, the dog is like ahead of the bicycle in this view. In the circumstance of pill detections, however, you can see that the pill have very similar visual attributes. So the framework has to rely on the more fine-grained features to differentiate them. And also, there's no spatial information contained in the image since they are all captured in the same surface. With this-
Are they different? So two similar ones?
Yes, there are two similar ones.
Yes.
This is just for similar- This is just an illustration to like show that the pill have very identical appearance.
Can you identify them, the difference, or only from the visual information?
That is the major problem that show the motivations of my work.
Okay, sounds interesting and challenging.
Yes.
Okay, with this diversion, I can conclude that the general object detection framework not dedicatedly designed for the pill detection task. And also, there are some previous work which also study the problem of pill detections. However, they all encounter the major issues which lying in their dataset. The problem is that in the dataset, in each image contain only one pill, and they are captured in the fixed setting of lighting as well as background. And here is the illustrations. Also, in previous study, they encounter the major drawback of like given an input image, I can consider the white pill here is called a hard sample case. And why it is hard? Because there are many pills with similar appearance to them. And all the previous study, which just relied on the visual appearance, cannot differentiate the hard sample. To this end, I formulate my draft.
Summarize.
Okay. Okay. Now I will summarize the problem up to this moment, like concerning about the dataset. As I previously mentioned, there are limits to only single pill image, and they are captures in fixed setting of illuminations and background. So it's not diversities and reflect the real world scenario. So I will conclude it lack of diversity. Concerning about the architectures, all the existing work relies only on the visual appearance, which is unable to handle the hard sample case. And no previous work has studied about the explainabilities of the model, which is very crucial in in a health related problem mm-hmm. and relate directly to human. So my goal set on this work is that I want to target the problem in which the input provided is an image which captures multiple pills in the patient intake, and I have to output the pill locations at where it correct label. And to tackle the problem mentioned previously, I will introduce a novel pill detection framework with high reliabilities and explainable capabilities, and also leverage the use of a new pill data set, which have the unconstrained conditions on background as well as lighting.
Can I ask a question?
Yes.
So where and in which situation do you want to use this kind of system? In the pharmacy or hospital or at home or on the prom?
Actually, the motivation of this work is come from old people. So for old people, so they when they have to take medicine, so they it's difficult for them to identify the idea of medicine. So it's often they often misuse medicine. So we build this one to help patients. Yes, also at home and. In hospital. Yes.
So you expect they use a like smartphone camera?
Yes. We have a POC application on camera, and user can use our application to take a picture of pills, and we will return the name of each pill in the image. Yes.
Thank you.
No question.
Yes.
How many categories of pills?
Yes.
Up to now,
about
the data set, mm-hmm. I have approximately 100 plus appeal. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Actually, in this project, so besides a proposed new architecture, so we also build our own data set, real world data sets, and we buy many pills, and we collect the prescription from a large hospital in Vietnam, and we take the picture of pill corresponding to prescription, and we build our own data set. Yes.
Okay, should I continue? Okay, that is the goal of my framework. The key idea is that the key idea about the framework is that I want to utilize the external knowledge to improve the detection accuracy, especially the head sample case that I mentioned earlier. And for that, I have modeled the three types of relationship between the pills. The first one is pill co-occurrent probabilities. The second is pill relative size, and the last is pill semantic correlations. For the first one, I will first model the frequency which the medications are prescribed together for treating some kind of disease. And the second is I want to reflect the likelihood that the pill appear in the same image so that I can enhance the accuracy in dealing with head sample by leveraging the contextual informations bring by the easy sample around that pill. And the second relationship is the relative size between the pill so that I can distinguish the pill of identical shape and color, but only different in their size. The last relationship is based on the relationship about their visual appearance between the pill that appear in the same image so that I can boosting up the accuracy by leveraging the inter-pill reactions. Here is the overview of my framework. We can be subdivided into three subcomponents. The first is the visual features extractor. We take the input as the image and then generate the visual features corresponding to that image and the region of interest also. Next, the next module The next module is called graph-based relational module, which is responsible for modeling the three graph that I mentioned earlier, the co-occurring one, the relative one, and the visual semantic one. The last module is the data fusion module, which merged the two sources of information that I stated earlier. The first is the visual features, and the second is the context information from the three type of graph, so that to enhance the final accuracy for the detection test. Okay, now let's jump into the first block of visual-based processing. Initially, I built the framework on top of Faster RCNN, but later on in my experiment, I will show that my detection head can be installed into any kind of detection backbone to boost up its accuracy in detecting pills. Okay, now let's come back to Faster RCNN. So it's consist of three major blocks. However, one notable thing is that I recognize that the ROI pooling operations cause a diminution in size information. And here is the illustration for that. To this end, this served as the main motivation for me to recreating the size information later on. Okay, now let's jump into the major contributions, which is the modeling of the two graph. The first graph is the co-occurring graph. I have the idea of extracting the prescription information so that I can model the co-occurring relationship between the pill. And here's the image of actual prescription taken from a hospital of Vietnam. And from it, I can extract two type of relations, two type of information. The first is the diagonal code, and the second is the medications. Since they all appear in the same prescription, I can define an explicit connection between them, which is pill diagonal relations. And since I have a set contain multiple prescriptions, I can infer the relationship that I can that I desire to build up, which is pill-pill relationship, by linking with the diagonal code I mentioned earlier. Let's break down the inner structure of the co-occurring graph. The first is that the set of the vertices correspond to all the pills which appear in the prescription set. The second is that the edge between the two nodes indicate the co-occurrence of them in at least one prescription. The last is about the weight. The weight is determined by considering the co-interactions of the two nodes over all diagonal code. Here is the formula for me to quantify the weight between the edge. And intuitively, the weight indicates the importance of the two pills, the relationship of them for curing some kind of disease. And this also takes into account of normalizing the pill that like supplement that are also that appear in almost all prescription set. Okay, now let's go to the relative size graph. By simply one time traversion over the previously built co-occurring graph, together with the bounding box annotations in the training data set, I can infer about the relative size between the pill and constructing the relative size graph. Okay, now let's go straightly to the third block of data fusion, which I will call graph-based relational modeling. Here is the structure a bit. Okay, now let's go to the first condensed graph, which is represent the information's appeal that most likely to appear in the image.
Okay, can you go to the detail of motivation, your motivation of this block, why we need the the condensed graph instead of the original graph.
Oh, I see. Mm-hmm. As mentioned earlier, the two general graph is built based on all informations from the prescription. So when given an image, input image, how can my model know which part of the general graph corresponding to that image? So that is the motivation for me to extract the condensed graph, which is dedicatedly represent the information that is actually related to the input image. Here is the architectures for modeling that motivations. It's consist of two subcomponents. The first is adaptive. The first is to formulate the condensed graph of the co-occurrent and the relative size graph, which I mentioned earlier.
Mm-hmm.
And also in this module, I build up the visual based graph,
mm-hmm.
Basing on the visual features of mm-hmm. of the pill, mm-hmm. Of the input image,
mm-hmm.
Which I call semantic relational graph constructor. And by fusing the two sources of information here, I have the condensed graph of three mm-hmm. kind of relations.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I will skip this part because I have mentioned about the motivations earlier. Okay, now let's talk more detail about the semantic graph relations. In fact, I have the idea of building the relations basing on the visual appearance mm-hmm. of the pill because I have read some work in the medical field which state that there exists some kind of implicit relations
mm-hmm.
between the pill visual appearance with their ingredient or their effect mm-hmm. to cure some kind of symptom.
Mm-hmm.
So I construct the graph semantic relational graph constructor to build up that kind of relationship mm-hmm. contained in the input image. And it simply built by the feature encoder, which take the visual features into another latent space in which their visual based relationship can be best expressed. Okay, the last module of the data fusion block is called graph transformer network, which I take from a previous study. It major role is to generate the final contact vector, which will have in the which will use for modeling the contextual pills around the hard sample mm-hmm. so that it can boost up the accuracy. About the loss, I also adopt a new auxiliary loss. The intuition of the loss is that the pill that frequently appear together should be predicted in the image with high probabilities. And second is that the pill that never appear together in the reality should also adversely be predicted in the image with low probabilities. Here's the visualizations. I want my framework to be capable and have the inference process like when it encounter an input image and is sure for the existence of a label, in this case N2, it will refer to the medical co-occurrent graph, and then it's try to increase the chance that the positive neighbor of label N2 to also appear in the image, while it also reduce the probabilities that the negative neighbor of N2 to be appear. So is it clear?
Mm-hmm.
Here is the formula for getting that objective, and is basing on contrastive plot, which consists of two terms, one for the positive neighbor and another for the negative. And by maximizing this slot, I can achieve the objective mentioned earlier. Okay, now let's jump to the performance evaluations of my framework. About the dataset, I propose the use of VIP dataset because as stated, all the previous one is not suitable for a real world scenario. So I and my team built a custom dataset which contain multiple pills in image and in very various lighting condition at red background, as you can see in the illustration. And also in this dataset, there contain an external knowledge of prescriptions, which are collected in four big hospitals of Vietnam. And all of the prescription is anonymous and fully cover the diagonal code as well as the medication. About the evaluation metric, since this is a subtask of object detections, I currently adopt COCO API for evaluations assessment. The most notable metric is the API, since it's the most generic one. Here are some evaluation scenario to verify the robustness of my framework. First, I will verify the robustness as well as its reliabilities by compare it with my backbone and also compare it with an existing framework that share the similar technique. The last is to verify its abilities in dealing with heavy occlusion samples. The following, I will also evaluate for its explainabilities by investigate the reasoning process of my framework. Last, I will conduct the ablation study to see the effect of each module on the overall performance. Compared with the backbone that I adopt for my model, which is faster RCNN and YOLO V5, which is representative for the two-step object detections and one-step object detection framework. As you can see from the summarized table, my framework make an improvement of at least 9% in the main AP metric compared with faster RCNN. And in the case of YOLO V5, it's also make a great gap of 12%. Also, I adopt a state of the art, which make use of visual based graph and spatial graph reasoning, which is quite identical with what I'm currently doing. And here's the summarized table for the result. And PGPNet, which is my framework, still make a gap of 4 in the main AP metric. And for other, it enhanced the performance from 9.5% to 70.1%. Here is the plot, which can illustrate for the reliabilities of my framework. And the construction of the plot is that when I have all the predictions made by a framework, I can divide the result into each bin corresponding to the confidence score. And after that, I can calculate the average accuracy for all the predictions in one bin. So in ideal scenario, the model should be have a high accuracy if the result produced by it have high confidence. Mm-hmm. And in contrast, when it not confident on its predictions, the corresponding accuracy should also be low. And in this figure, you can see that the red dashed line is the perfect scenario in which the model perform its very trustworthy and reliability is performing. Compared with all three benchmarks that I mentioned earlier, my framework, which is the violet, is closer to the perfect red line as shown. Okay, now let's jump to the explainability investigations. To study this, I choose a label which is called hexibon 8 milligram. And here are some pills with approximately same size, shape and color with this label. And as you can see, from the data set, which contain only 96 class, and I list here 5 class with very high visual, with very similar visual appearance with this label. So this one can be considered a hard label. Here is the saliency map that produced with a technique, which is excitation backpropagation. And what saliency map tells us, it tells us that which sections of the original input corresponding and directly affect a given logic of the output. Mm-hmm. And here is the image which contains the 3 label, which is levelin fraud, hapensin and hexibon 8 milligram, which is my investigation label. And as you can see, for the simple label of levelin or hapensin, the classifier only focus on the exact locations of that tablet to determine its correct label. Mm-hmm. However, in the case of hexibon 8 milligram, information on both hexibon as well as levelin fraud serve as the evidence to produce that output logic of hexibon. Next, I also study how the graph generator generate the context vector for the hexibon 8 milligram. Mm-hmm. And to better presentations, I take 10 regions of interest in the image, 5 of which had the highest objectiveness score, and the 5 other with the lowest score, which corresponding to the background. As you can see in the image on the left, the rectangle in the gray color corresponding to the background, and the yellow, the orange and the blue one corresponding to the exact pill. Mm-hmm. And this is the subgraph, which is represent which contextual pill that that directly affect the generation process of the contact vector for the hexibon 8 milligram. Mm-hmm. The weight of the edge can be inferred by the color. Mm-hmm. of the graph. And as you can see, all the background had very dim edge, which represent they are not very related to generate the contact vector for hexibon. But in fact, all the important edge are directly linked from the region of interest that corresponding to the contextual pill to the region of interest of hexibon. Mm-hmm. Last is the ablation study, which I conduct to see the effect of each module on overall performance of my framework. And here, and from the table, you can see that different version with the minus one indicate the absence of that module, and the plus indicate the presence of a module. And this is the visualizations about the performance metric. And as you can see overall, with only use of medical co-occurrence graph, which is my major contribution, the performance is greatly enhanced compared with the vanilla faster RCNN. And in all case, or any ablations of any module or cause a decrease in the overall performance. Okay, that is the end of my work. Mm-hmm. Now I will switch back.
Can I ask some questions?
Yes.
So okay, from this slide, so what's the realistic average precision do you want to have? Like now 70, the best one is about 70. Is it already good enough in practice?
This work, in fact, I have only limit at that defining the best one compared with the baseline, and to say that is it 50 good enough, I think at the moment I have to have the support of some like pharmacists or any kinds to verify the trustworthy of our framework, and we only target this framework to aid the process of detecting pills, but not totally replace the human. Yeah.
How is this technology used in real operation involving the patients and the pharmacists and so on?
I'm currently finished to like build up this framework and install it into our applications, but we have not published it to the communities yet.
Yes.
So for instance, do pharmacists use this technology to solve that? No. Maybe somebody is supposed to put the pills into the pill case.
Yes.
You know, the pill case.
Yes.
Yeah.
And if that is done, then elderly people will be able to,
yes. But pill case is not common in Vietnam.
Uh-huh.
In Vietnam, we don't have a pill case.
Uh-huh.
Yes.
Very expensive.
Vietnam is like quite special.
Uh-huh.
Specific. It's different from Chopin. Yes.
Can I also ask a few more minor questions?
Yes.
Let's go back to the slide of heat map, the salinity map.
Okay.
Yeah.
In the right hand side, you have a case of having two plots that are activated. Can you somehow avoid this easily? Because we know that a tablet is a kind of convex shape, and one tablet is just one region.
Mm-hmm.
If we find two regions, then this is clearly something wrong. Can we somehow incorporate that kind of knowledge when we classify? On the right hand side, so this is clearly wrong.
Right.
For one tablet, two regions are active. It shouldn't happen because we know the shape of the tablet is convex.
Uh-huh.
Oh, what we mean by this salinity map is that our framework, since we're trying to incorporate the contextual pill informations into detecting the heart sample. So this salinity map say that the only information from the hexavalent only is not substantial to correctly differentiate that pill. Because as mentioned earlier, this chosen label is the heart sample case, in which there are many different labels with similar appearance to it. In our data set. So
that's understandable, but can we go beyond that? From the right hand side, we know that this is something wrong.
Yes.
There's some additional consequence to talk about. The performance should be improved.
Something wrong in the right side.
For detecting one pill, one tablet, it is impossible to have two regions that we are with. This is always wrong.
Yes.
Mm. Of course, probably not. We know that from the prediction is somewhat unreliable.
Yes.
But no, we don't want to really have that. We want to improve the performance.
Yes. That. Yes. So, Professor Sugiyama means that. So, to identify one tablet, so we should use information of only one reason instead of two reasons, like this.
This is a kind of assumption, but this should be true.
Uh-huh, yeah.
If you identify this tablet, maybe this information is not useful.
Uh-huh. Yes, I see.
Yeah.
Yes. Yes, thank you for your advice.
As I have investigated about the explainable AI and some kind of that, there are some work which show the salinity map. For example, the parent and a child, and to correctly classify the the parent asks, for example, the father,
mm-hmm.
the salience map relied on the information of the child.
Mm-hmm.
And since they appear in the same image, the module itself somehow learned that it should based on the information from the child to mm-hmm. correctly classify the label of that father to be father.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And this saliency map I present here, I put it here just to show that my framework capture the contextual information and use that
mm-hmm.
to classify the hard sample. And for the easy sample, it's relied on the visual appearance itself. Yeah.
So in that case, so are you saying the Xbon 8 microgram and Libolin 40? So these two are these two co-worker quite frequently.
Yes. Yes.
Right. So this is the red solution.
Yes.
Yes.
That is really good.
You can. We can check it in this graph. This graph is a co-occurrence graph, and yes.
Can I also quickly see the slide of loss function again?
Yeah.
So you are given, you had a graph, and graph was basically used as a weight.
Mm-hmm.
Co-occurrence probability. It performs quickly follow this.
Yeah.
I wanted to ask, so where does the information provided by the graph
mm-hmm.
included in this equation?
The information from the graph is actually used to determine what is the positive label and what mm-hmm. is negative label corresponding to the actual label of region of interest, LI, I mentioned here. You can see in the image for the better illustration. From the illustration, you can see that my framework is sure for the existence of label N2. For example, this region of interest have the high probabilities logit corresponding to label N2. So it should refer to the co-occurrence graph to extract the positive neighbor of the label N2. For example, N2 link with N1 and Ni here. So it should boost the probabilities that the label N1 and Ni also appear in the image by consider the probabilities produced over all region of interest, which is Ni pos here.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you very much.
Yeah. Thank you very much.
Okay. You have any other questions?
Yeah, no questions.
Yes.
But now you are using the explainability of your method. You are using the heat map.
Mm-hmm.
Why not use the other method, for example, like by making prediction like this, we use this example to make a prediction like this here, like showing examples to patients. Okay, I make this prediction, I look at this example. For example, we can use inference functions to highlight the importance of the training example to this prediction. Yeah. So what do you think? I mean, by making this condition, I refer to this. Mm-hmm. I refer to this example and make this condition. When I make a prediction of these pairs, I look at, because I look at these pairs, I make a prediction, this is this pair. What do you think about this?
You mean some kind of other representations for example, the attentions?
Attention is kind of like your things. It's more like other methods for
mm-hmm.
explainability.
Mm-hmm.
You can see the other method.
Mm-hmm. Not heat map, but another. In our work, so we use a heat map and a
yes.
graph, subgraph
yes.
to try to explain our process.
Yeah.
Yes, but yes, we can consider another method.
Other method. Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay.
Yes, thank you very much.
Yeah.
Yeah, maybe.
Yes.
I'm considering No problem. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Sometimes when we see the doctors, mm-hmm. the doctors suggest us to have the pills.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes just have the half the pills or uh-huh. several pills. So I'm curious what have happened in this case in your system.
Only a part of pill.
Yes, only mm-hmm. a part of pill. And maybe pill. When we cut the pill, the shape mm-hmm. will be different.
Yeah.
It's a very
yeah. Yeah.
Maybe we have to collect such kind of data and train
yeah.
the model. So for the same label, so we have a lot of images, okay. The whole pill and a part of pill with the same label.
Okay.
I think.
I think in our audience, the remotely they have a question.
Mm-hmm.
Thomas want to ask.
Hi, hello.
Hello.
Can I ask the question?
Yes.
So I have a question related to the quality of the images. I understand in the future, this application, you will use different smartphones, different quality of cameras.
Mm-hmm.
How do you deal with different quality of input images? And I ask the question because you mentioned at the beginning federated learning. Mm-hmm. So will be the federated learning the idea to kind of like standardize the camera in the smartphone
mm-hmm.
to use it with your model?
Okay. We use a normal smartphone. Yes, in Vietnam, and actually we have five or more smartphones, 5 or 10.
I think more.
More.
About 10.
Yes, we have a student. We have many students, and they use their own smartphone to take
different one
in different condition. Mm-hmm. Yes.
So basically, your model is independent of the quality of the images, right? You don't need to any like standardization.
Yes, we don't have any constraint on the image quality. Yes.
Okay, thank you very much. Very nice idea. Thank you.
May I have
a
question?
Yes.
So
in the applications, do you run your model on the phone or you upload the image to the cloud?
Mm.
So on the phone, run model on the
phone. Our model run on server.
Oh.
Yes. Yes. But it's quite
yes.
Yes.
Small question.
Yes.
Because the tablet or these are like artificial objects, can you somehow generate additional data in a data organization way? The computer graphics can really make nice.
Yes. Yes. Actually, we can use augmentation to enrich the training data, but I think we have to build a large enough real data set. And based on that data set, so we can use some augmentation method to enlarge more, but we should have a basic clear data set. Yes. So should I move
on to the next?
Okay, thank you very much. So, okay. Okay, so next I would like to share with you about our work on federated learning under non-ideal and uncontrollable clients data. So why we come up with federated learning, that is because the privacy, data privacy is very like big concern in AI in smart health, because the health related information is very sensitive. So we have to preserve the clients data. So we use federated learning to train global model using data from multiple clients. As you know, so federated learning is a distributed learning mechanism that exploits data from multiple clients. And in a federated learning framework, there are many clients and a central server, and the global model will be trained using multiple communication routes. And in each communication route, so the server will choose a random subset of client and send the global weight to the clients. The clients will train the model using their own private data, and after training, they will send the weight to the server, and the server will perform aggregation to generate the updated global model for the next communication route. And In here is a very like a basic formula for aggregation in the server side, and we have WT plus one as the global weight at the route T plus one, and we have WIT as the local weight of client I at the route T, and alpha I is the impact factor of client I at the route T. And you can see that the impact factor is very important that affect the global model. So there are many work that focus on how to determine the impact factor. And we have investigate, so which should be the criteria for determining the impact factor. And we found that the impact factor should be determined based on two criteria. And the first one is the goodness of knowledge acquired by the clients. And the second is the correlation between the knowledge learned by the clients. So why we think that is because, for example, concerning the first point, so clients with better knowledge should be assigned higher impact factor. And for the second point, so knowledge repeated gained by multiple clients should be assigned lower impact factor, because we should do that because we have to avoid the model to overfit in specific knowledge.
And is the impact factor independent of time?
Yes, it may be fixed, or it may be changed over a communication route, depend on the policy.
Maybe in the beginning, maybe uniform weightage.
So yes. Good. Yes.
Later, some clients are doing.
Yes. Sure. Okay. So you can see here. Uh-huh. Yes, we have a very like a pioneer in infected learning that is fed average, and in fed average, so they use a fixed impact factor, and the impact factor is proportional with the volume of data at the client. Here we have impact factor to be NK over N, with NK is the data volume of the client K, and N is the total data on the client. And this impact factor is fixed in on the training process. And so if we use this formula to aggregate the local model, so it means that we consider all sample equally, all sample contribute the equal roles in the global model. But actually different sample may contribute different, put different impact on the global model. So this fed average only work well with the IID data, that is a scenario when all the client have the same data distribution, and it does not work when we think about non-ID data. And actually there are many existing work addressing the non-ID data infected learning. And most of work focus on two types of non-ID data, that is label skew and quantity skew. And label skew means that the label distribution differ between the client and following some particular distribution like power law or direct distribution. And for the quantity skew, so different clients hold different amount of data, but the same label set. But when we come with our problem in VIP project, so we found that there is another kind of non-ID data, as you can see in this finger. And we call that non-ID data as cluster skew non-ID, because when we think about the pure images, so the images collected by patients with the same disease will have the same distribution, and they will form a cluster. And such kind of non-ID data has not been mentioned in any existing work. So that's a motivation of our work. And another problem of the existing approach is that they try to design the impact factor based on the knowledge on the distribution of client data. it means that each work is like suitable for only specific type of data distribution at client, at the client. And we aim at a solution that can automatically adjust with the any kind of distribution at the client. We don't need any like knowledge about the client data's distribution. And our idea is to use reinforcement learning. So we use a reinforcement learning agent at the server, and that agent will learn the distribution of client data, and it will adjust the impact factor over the communication route and reach the suboptimal impact factor and assign that one to the client. Here is the overview of our architecture, and we adopt the DDPG, like a DDPG framework for our deep reinforcement learning agent. And you can see here, we have a target network and mean network. And so for the formulation of our deep reinforcement learning framework, so we formulate the state as a tuple consisting of three information. The first one is inference loss of the global model on the client. And the second one is inference loss of the local model on its data set. And the first one can be seen as the inference loss at the beginning of the communication route. And the second one is the improvement, that is the loss after training using the local in data as the communication route. And we have NK as the data volume at the client. And the action will be the parameter in the Gaussian distribution, that is the mean and the variance of a Gaussian distribution. And with this one, we will generate a random impact factor for each client. And here is our reward function. And you can see that our reward function has two terms. And the first one is the like average of the loss of own client. And the second one is the, sorry, the second one is the gap between the maximum and minimum loss of the client. So by the first term, we want to minimize the loss of own client. And by the second term, we want to balance between own client. We don't want to bias to any client, but we want to balance among them. And we also propose a training strategy. Yes.
Can you show that this is an MDP?
Pardon?
So state transition, is it the Markov process?
Yes, actually reinforcement learning is a Markov process. But we don't know the state transition. It's not explicit. We cannot formulate the explicit the state transition probability.
Yeah.
Yes.
So this is always a challenge.
In yes. Like a trial. Yes.
Sometimes the program is not really an MVP.
Yes.
The output is somewhat unreliable.
Yes. Yes, it's a trial and error. Yes.
Okay.
Is that possible? You can use multi-agent reinforcement.
Yes, that is in our training to state training mechanism. So in the first state we want to collect as many experience as possible. So we use multiple agents, and all the agents will run parallelly to generate many experience, and we use that experience to train the agent. And the second state, we train online and we use only one agent. Yes.
Okay.
Thank you. Okay. And okay. So I will go to the our experiment, and we use three type of like non-ID pattern: PI, CE, and CN. PI is for Pareto, and CE, I'm not sure about that, something in it's a method to divide the data. The data, yes. And we used three data sets, CIFAR 100, Fashion, MNIST, and MNIST. And our proposal show the best accuracy in most of scenario compared to the state of the art federated learning. You can see here. And the single set show the like the upper bound accuracy that we train the global model using the data from all the client. And we also compare the conversion rate of all the methods and our approach get the best conversion rate here.
I'm just curious.
Yes. So,
qualitatively, can you say that what kind of impact factor can you obtain?
Impact factor?
Because it's long, right? By your method.
Yes.
So the baseline method is fed.
Fed average and fed proc is two baseline method and fed LR deep reinforcement learning is ours.
Mm-hmm. Yes. The weighting factor is different.
Yes, yes. The impact factor is different.
Yeah. So yes. Can you somehow observe what kind of impact factors can you obtain?
In our method, so the impact factor varies over the commission round. Is it not fixed?
Yeah.
Yes.
Can somehow explain the tendency of what kind of impact factor?
Okay. We try to adapt the impact factor based on these two criteria. That is the client that has good knowledge will be assigned higher impact factor. But actually we focus more on the second one. That's we try to assign a smaller impact factor to client belonging to a cluster containing more client.
And yes. That part was designed in the real world.
So in reward function we have here we have two terms, so here we try to balance to minimize the gap between the best client and the worst client. We don't want to bias on any client.
Can you learn this from inverse reinforcement learning or imitation learning? Because once you design this, the obtained results are somewhat manually controlled. You can really learn the real function from data.
Yes, when we perform the experiment, so we plot all of these metric, and we observe the behavior, and we try to train a lot of hyperparameter and reward function to make the result follow our hypothesis. Yes.
At least you can encode some hyperparameters in the real world function and tune them.
Sure.
Like
yes.
Balance between two terms.
Yes. 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 We can insert some like weight here. Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Weight here. Yes. And train that. Yes. Thank you. Yes. Thank you very much. Okay, so and we also here is the accuracy of a communication graph for different fed average methods, and we can see the difference between ours, the red line and the other one. Okay. So I will go fastly to our second work also on federated learning. And it is somehow similar to the first one, and it is also motivated by the cluster skill, non-ID data type. But in this work, so we observe that the existing resource either focus on aggregation on the server side or the local training at the client side. That are two important phase in federated learning, but existing goals also focus either one of them. And in this work, we propose a dual optimization on both server side and the client side. And on the server side, we propose a cluster-based aggregation mechanism and at the client side, so we use a knowledge distillation based regularization. Okay, so this is the operation in one communication route of fettered learning that I have mentioned before. So we use this formula to aggregate the local model from clients, and in fact average, so this impact factor is proportional with the number of sample at each client. But in our proposal, so actually we have a small test that if we assign the impact factor inversely proportional with the number of clients in each cluster, so can we improve the accuracy of the model? And we verify that if we put the inverse proportional with the number of clients in each cluster in impact factor, so the accuracy improved much. And then our idea is to cluster client into cluster, and the client in the same cluster will have the same data distribution. But the problem is that how the server know about the data distribution of clients, because server have no knowledge about the data of the client. So that is a big challenge for us. And okay, so.
But do you renormalize the weight?
Yes, yes, renormalize to the number of clients in each cluster. But the problem is how to cluster.
No, the sum to one, otherwise the weight value gets smaller.
Ah, yes, so
you
yes.
Divide
it. Yes, we have to normalize at last. Yes, here we have a very interesting insight about how to cluster the client. So we want to cluster client based on their data characteristic, but the server don't know about the data of the client. So how can we know about the data of the client? And we found that actually the penultimate layer of the client of the model tell us much about the training data. You can see this is the penultimate layer of a simple encoder decoder classifier. And we have a test here. You can see that if we train the model with a sample of one class, say class H, so the weight of that class will be positive, will have positive gradient, while the weight of other class will have negative gradient. And we did another experiment where we train model with sample of multiple classes, like train model with classes 5 and 7. So we saw that the weight of other class only have negative values, while that of the class with sample have positive and negative value. So it means that we observe the penultimate layer, so we can know about the training data of client. And then we use this information to cluster the client. And that is our main idea for this work. And we also have some theoretical proof for this hypothesis. Yes. And but we cope with another challenge. That is because, as I mentioned before, so in fettered learning, we don't train own client in every communication round, but in each communication round, only a portion of client participating in the training process. So we don't have the penultimate layer of own client at the same time. So we have to some method to like collect the information of client over communication round. And the second challenge is that the raw data of the raw gradient of penultimate layer is very, very, very small, and we cannot use that information to cluster client model. And we have some idea to address this challenge. So for the first one, this one, so we use a so-called similarity metric that represent the similarity of client. And this metric will be updated over the communication graph. using this one. For each communication route, so we calculate the similarity of clients participating in that communication route, and we use this formula to update the corresponding item in the similarity matrix here. And then we use a min max scaling to address the second problem, and we have the Q metric. And then we use binarization to convert from the Q metric to binary metric that indicating which client belong to the same cluster with which client. And we have a metric representing the cluster. And moreover, to enhance the speed for converse of the similarity metric, so we have we use another like a theoretical result to like estimate the similarity of two clients via their similarities with other clients. For example, if we have similarity of SUI of client U and client J, and we also have similarity of client U and client I, so we can use this inequality to estimate the similarity of client I and client J. And we use this algorithm to estimate the similarity. And we also have a theorem to concerning the conversion rate of the similarity metric. Yes, here's the flow to clustering the client. Yes, and besides the cluster-based aggregation, we also propose a knowledge distillation-based regularization at the client side, because we have an observation that when the local data of client is very small, so the training process of the client will be quickly overfit to the local data of client, as you can see in this finger. So this is the log at the beginning of a communication round, and only after like 10 epochs, and the log will be approach zero. It overfit to the local data. So we have to have some regularization technique to alleviate this phenomenon. And our observation is that we because we see that the global model is the aggregation of multiple local model, so it will have a higher generalizability than the local model. So we will use a knowledge distillation to guide the global client model to close to the global model, and we design this log on the local training. Yes, and this is the result of our proposed method. And in all of the table, we measure the accuracy of our proposal and compare with the state of the art, like FedProc or FedFA or FedDIN, and Cardit is our proposal. And the red one is the best one, and the blue is the second best. And we also perform the experiment on the pure data set, that is data set on the pure images built by our own. And you can see that our proposal shows the best method in many scenarios here, like in this table or in this table or in this one. Okay, and here are some experiments to verify the impact of our proposal transitive similarity calculation algorithm. And by using our algorithm, so the similarity metric converts more faster. And here's the some impact of parameter, hyperparameter in our algorithm. Yes, actually we have another work on back the attack on fatal learning, but I think it's quite long. So I would like to finish my presentation here.
Do you have any final slide?
Yes, this is final of my slide.
The conclusion slide or something. Otherwise, yeah.
Okay, so yes, I would like to finish my presentation here. Yes.
Okay, so thank you very much. Any questions? So we have three talks basically, and questions to any part is fine. Well, something else is also
fine. So in the spirited learning case, did yes. you use real data from VIP
yes. users? Yes, we use here. Yeah. You can see in data set here, Pew. Pew is the data set, the Pew images. Uh-huh. Yes, okay. Like,
So what kind of other data are there in?
In fettered learning, so other works in fettered learning usually use a common data set like MNIST or CIFA, and we also use the common public data set. And besides, we also use our own data
set. I'm talking about the data in VIPIC.
Data in VIPIC, we have Pew image and prescription uh-huh. and ECG signal.
Uh-huh.
Yes.
Okay. And of course, the kind types of data will be expanded in the future.
Yes. Uh-huh. We also public. We have some work under review. So when the work has been accessible, we will release our data sets. Yes.
And the fact that you are trying to use this predictive learning, it means that the data, VIP data, is controlled by the end user themselves.
Yes, uh-huh. sure.
On what kind of infrastructure?
Actually, in the world, there's a real fettered learning system. It's very rare.
Talking about the infrastructure for the end users to control mm-hmm. manage their data rather than the learning.
You mean the data?
Yeah, so each person controls his own data, right?
Yes, we can think about two kind of scenario. That the first one is we take the data from user, end user.
Yeah.
And the second one is that we take the data from a third party, like pharmacy or hospital.
I'm talking about the kind of technology you are using for the end users to control their data.
Technology for control data? Yeah, you mean communication?
Some kind of personal data store.
Yes.
To be used there.
For the end user, so the yeah. data will be stored on their smartphone.
Smartphone.
Yes.
Not just smartphone, but also it's in some cloud or something, or for the sake of
yes, maybe
cloud. Data with other
yes,
users, right?
Yes, yes.
So, what kind of software is that?
That is not in the research objective of federate learning.
Of course not.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. But I myself am considering
uh-huh. yes.
that infrastructure part. So I'm. So
yes.
Maybe we could collaborate on that level.
Oh,
right. Yes. So because that's my mm-hmm. research.
which is your research domain? Can I
ask? Personal data store.
Oh. Like how to encrypt data? Or
end-to-end encryption
mm-hmm.
and sharing data. Uh-huh. By the end users
mm-hmm.
Among themselves, and then disclose
yes.
the data to mm-hmm. Other parties like mm-hmm. Medical organizations mm-hmm. and so on.
Or like efficiently store
right.
data to right. to save the space like encoding.
Like yeah, yeah. So for instance, the software should be able to translate
uh-huh.
Data from the outside into some normalized
flow, uh-huh.
right? And yes. so this tool must be able to do all these things.
Yes, we have not think about that. Yeah. But it's very interesting yeah,
in
and
that
I
case,
yes,
yeah,
we hope thought, that we can
right.
collaborate in the future. Yes, thank you very much.
I also have a question on this page.
Yes.
So in table two, you have a lot of NAs. I found a caption below the table.
Yes.
But what's the reason not to reach the target accuracy?
Yes. Yes. Actually, I'm not the person that this experiment, but I heard from the person in charge that in this experiment, so they set a threshold for accuracy, and they measure the time to reach that accuracy. But for some methods, so that method cannot reach that threshold.
Mm-hmm.
So the result is NA.
Right.
Can you think of the reason why they cannot achieve?
Okay, because each method here is designed for specific type of data.
Mm.
And so for some type of data, so it does not work.
Mm.
Their performance are very unstable.
Oh.
Yes. For example, like you can see some method may be very good at some scenario, but very, very worse at other scenarios. Mm-hmm.
But the proposed method is more stable for all kinds of data
sets. Yes, for all the all of our scenario.
Okay, other questions?
Do you have any future plans for like extending this application by B?
Yes.
By adding some more functions like automatic diagnosis?
Yes, actually there are some companies
uh-huh.
like hospital and pharmacy came with us.
Right.
Our project won a big award in AI contest in Vietnam this year.
Uh-huh.
And after winning that award, so a big company. So
who operates this contest?
A journal of Vietnam.
Uh-huh.
Newspaper.
Yeah, newspaper.
VSVN Express AI Award, Vietnam AI Award, and we won the big award from that. And after that, so VinBrain, very big company in Vietnam, and VinMec came with us and. The biggest pharmacy in Vietnam also came with us, and they want to use our API in their application. They already have application for telehealth, like VinBrain. They have their own application for telehealth, and they use some of our function, include integrated in.
Does the national health insurance in Vietnam support telehealth, include telehealth?
Insurance. I don't know about that. Sorry, I don't know about that.
I think not. Yeah, I think because it could have been medicalized.
Yeah,
mm-hmm.
Much
like the limit is much.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So it's attached on the level really for the public.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And so I think the funding is less.
Yes.
So the government is trying to extend the mandatory insurance to 100%, something like that.
Yes.
But the contributions are very low.
Yeah.
Low income. So, well, it's not comparable to the Chinese.
Yes, yes. It's different from
the government.
I don't think they have to. That's how they do to, as you said, scarcity or shortage of medical resources in Vietnam, right?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
There are few medical doctors.
Yes.
So in order to compensate that, automatic diagnosis would be quite nice. More visit.
Yes.
So in that respect, AIP may be able to contribute.
Yes.
Yeah, actually, that's an important part. I need to tell everybody that we plan to have a joint workshop.
Uh-huh.
Between AIP and organization in Vietnam, hopefully next spring we'll have So then, AIP has three groups. The one is working on the fundamental machine learning stuff, like theory and algorithm.
Uh-huh.
The second group is working on more application, medical research,
medical
application.
Yes.
And third group is working on like society,
AIP.
Is the group director of that one.
Yes.
And I think we can find many common topics.
Yes.
And hopefully some of the audiences they can join the discussion when we plan the workshop.
Yes.
That's the most important message today. So she's actually a delegate from Vietnam to really have a joint workshop. So I'd like to thank both of you for being here today.
Thank you very much.
And hope that we can continue having
Thank you very much.
Okay, so let me please join me to thank the speakers again.
Mm-hmm.